Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this webinar on rail career opportunities in Egypt. So I can see most of you have been who've joined this session have been following our webinars, masterclasses, and even have attended our course program. So I welcome you all to this first ever international audience focus session in collaboration with Mr. University of Science and Technology, Egypt. Today, we are aiming to cover four distinct aspects. We want to cover the growth opportunities which are coming in the rail and transportation sector in the MENA region, specifically focusing on the Egypt region. Secondly, what kind of career opportunities are evolving for young engineers and also working engineers who are looking at international career options in UAE, Egypt, or Arab countries. Today, we've also got an expert with us, Mr. Ahmed Nabil, who will be taking up a session on track engineering opportunities and basics for fresher graduates and engineers who to make them aware about what railway engineering is all about. In addition to this, Railway Academy is proud to announce and that we are collaborating with Misr University of Science and Technology, Cairo, to launch training programs which will be certified by the university for young engineers and graduates who are looking at upskilling themselves in railway technologies. These certification, we also believe, will be very valuable for people who are looking at international opportunities in Middle East and African countries and Egypt. So we'll be talking about the new courses that we are building with Miss University of Science and Technology. We'll talk about it. I can see. Okay. I would encourage you to share your introductions in the chat box so that participants can know about you. It's a good opportunity to network, and we would encourage you to network with each other, exchange your introductions, and take benefit of networking. So these are the four elements that we would like to cover today: growth in rail and transportation sector, career opportunities for young engineers, and we have an expert who will talk about track engineering opportunities, and we will also announce few courses that we are working in collaboration with MESS University. So ideally, who should be attending this webinar? So in 1.5 hours, we cannot cover everything. So we have designed this entire webinar for fresher engineers who are looking at high growth options in the railway sector. Working professionals, be it from India or any part of the world, looking at opportunities in the MENA region. Rail professionals who are already in the in Egypt or MENA region and looking for career growth in rail industry. We'll talk about what all opportunities are coming up, projects which are coming up. And we've designed this section around opportunities which are open for all branches of engineering: mechanical, civil, power electronics, power engineering, instrumentation, and even computer science graduates or professionals can explore rail and allied transportation industry. I'm Sumit Kanu. I'm founder of Railway Academy, and we have been running rail specific courses for last 5 years now, and we have trained more than 5,000 people, and our students are working right now in top of the world rail companies around the world. We have 15 to 20% international student participation into our course programs that we launch. We offer 50 plus courses around six key domains of railway technologies, railway signaling, railway electrification and operations, rams and rail safety, rail management, metro and high-speed rail technologies. And we even provide coaching for IRSC module exams. So we have one of the largest rail course portfolio in Asia. So today we'll not talk about it in much more detail. We'll focus on the agenda for this webinar. We would, so people who are interested to know about our course program can visit our website. We have collaborations with TUV South, SUD South Asia as a certification partner. We have collaborated with RailPerson, which is an HR organization which provides job opportunities internationally to rail candidates around the world. We've collaborated with number one engineering institute in India, which is IIT Madras Pravartak, to offer courses in rail cybersecurity and artificial intelligence application in railways. We also have collaborations with IIMs, Indian Institute of Management, which is premium. I would request participants to mute them then. Okay. So we also have collaborations with private universities in India with whom we are doing postgraduate course programs. Now, you can follow us on social media and we will give more details about it towards the end of the session. Now, I would like to invite our partner, the esteemed Miss University of Science and Technology, and we have with us Dr. Gada Amar to share more insights about Miss University and their course portfolio. Welcome, ma'am. I hope the problem is sorted now. Okay, so I think there is some technical issues. I think she will be joining a little bit later. So Miss University of Technology has been has established in 1996, and since then it's a nationally recognized technological institution, university in Egypt, and with nearly 20,000 plus students. So it is a legally recognized educational institute with all educational authorities. And they're also an active member of Association of Arab Universities and the International Association of University Presidents and Association of African Universities. They're an active member there. The College of Engineering is one of the reputed ones in the entire Egypt and Arab countries. And thousands of their students are working in the industry in various positions of repute. So equipped with fantastic infrastructure. I personally visited Miss University, and it is one of the most beautiful campuses I've seen there in Egypt. And they have got fantastic leaders in the university who are adaptive, agile, and welcoming to collaborations to give their students new career options. So we have collaborated with the engineering departments, and they have nine disciplines of engineering departments in their university. So from construction, architecture, mechanical, industrial and system engineering, computer and software engineering, electronics, biomedical, electrical power, machines engineering, mechatronics, and they also have a department on basic sciences. Now, talking about the rail industry, so the global market for rail transportation is estimated around $457 billion in 2022, a massive number. This market is projected to reach around $700 billion by 2030 and is growing at a CAGR of 5.3. So a huge industry in itself. When we talk in the Egypt context, more than 20 railway, metro, light rail, and monorail projects are underway or planned in Egypt. Many of them have got delivered as well. There is a 60-kilometer line in northern Egypt, 330 kilometers double track line from En Sokhna to October 6 city to Borgel Arab. 1,100 kilometer second line is running from Greater Cairo area, passing through Quena, Luxor, Aswan to Abu Simbel. A 225 kilometer third line is connecting Quena with to Safaga on the Red Sea, serving World Heritage archaeological sites. So there's a massive investment going in Egypt, and it is emerging as one of the investment hotspot for railways in the region. And I personally visited Transmia last year in November, and I saw those developments myself. So we interacted, I attended once a year conference in Cairo, where we I had the opportunity to interact with many rail companies and understand their expansion plans and implementation projects in Egypt and Arab, other Arab countries. So a lot of development is going on in Egypt and Arab countries. So we'll talk about it as we'll go forward. So we'll take up various projects. We'll talk about country-wise opportunities which are coming up in this region. When we talk about these opportunities, we need to also talk about that these opportunities will result in massive employment and career opportunities, especially in Egypt and African countries. And there will be a significant demand for professionals in Egypt and African countries to be part of the emerging rail industry there. The domains that we have been able to identify so far are around railway signaling applications, which are railway signaling, signaling design, RAMs and functional safety in rail projects. So we have RAMs and ISAs, functional safety audits and case demonstrations. Then ERTMS is being implemented in high-speed rails, GOA4 technology, cybersecurity, artificial intelligence applications, CTC, PTCs are being implemented. Railway engineering, track construction is going on massively in that region. Overhead electrification, rolling stock engineers are required, railway traction engineers are required, and also non-engineering domains, specifically in management, project management professionals are needed, people who could do rail project costings, then people who could manage intercontinental rail connectivity projects going on in the region. Contract management professional. So around these five domains, a lot of employment opportunities are shaping up in the MENA region. So what does this mean for us, for you, in fact? This means that all the major contractor companies in these regions, the Arab contractors, Siemens is doing massive project work in Egypt. Alstom is doing a massive project work in Egypt. And Aegis has bagged a massive project in Qatar as well as Egypt. Atkins, Ansaldo, Deutsche Bahn, Thales, Bombardier. So all these companies have been doing, have grabbed huge projects in this particular region. And more than 50 plus companies are working in various capacities in Egypt and African countries, where career opportunities exist for rail professionals at various levels. The opportunities are also coming up through Etihad Rail, Egyptian Railways, and Kuwait National Railroad Network, Kuwait Metropolitan Rapid Transit Systems. So these opportunities are also coming up within government agencies for Arab nationals, which can be explored. So I was able to interact with rail industry officials in these countries and found that they're very much optimistic to participation and collaboration with international professionals. So there's a good number of diplomats who are working in those countries. So I have invited a few rail experts from Egypt region to share their insights today with you all. So as we proceed with the webinar, they will be joining us and would be sharing more details on this. What kind of opportunities are shaping up in numerous companies? So railways and railroads, there are companies who are operating in rolling stock, locomotives and wagons, mechanical parts manufacturers, maintenance equipment, railway operators, tracks, freight facilities, routing signals, signaling and communications, rail profile measurement system, command and control rooms, access control equipments. So IT and software and digital technologies, terminals and facilities, display systems, ticketing and payment automation. So all these, there is a requirement of trained manpower at all these levels. When we come to tunnels and metros, tunnel infrastructure, train and metros, cars, light rail, trains and monorails, metro operators, monitoring and camera systems, maintenance equipment, fiber optic cables, metro interiors and lighting fixtures, station and terminal buildings, escalators, elevators, emergency systems and equipment, detection information and warning systems, telecommunication, even Wi-Fi providers. So we have opportunities shaping up all around the domain within these regions. Not only in rail, because we are seeing multimodal transportation systems coming up in Abu Dhabi. Even Kuwait Metropolitan System is working on multimodal systems. So there is an integrated transport solutions are being developed in this region, thereby opening up opportunities for engineers in maritime transport, ports and logistics, green and sustainable mobility, roads and bridges. You can explore numerous opportunities in these regions around multimodal systems, cargo inspection equipments, logistical equipments, freight terminals, even hybrid electric passenger vehicles, low carbon emission norms, solar power, road construction material, equipment and machineries, infrastructure construction and civil engineering companies. So massive opportunities are coming around the sector, even in the allied ones. Now, one of the important points, how much does the rail engineer make in Cairo? So this is something that we've been able to estimate on a broad terms. This would vary as per the capability, skill, and experience of the person, the kind of projects you've worked on, kind of relevancy you have with these, the project requirements. So average annual salary for a rail professional in Cairo is almost around 107,000 Egyptian pounds. So you can multiply that with 2.21 for INRs, and you can do the conversion yourself. I'll leave the conversion calculations at your end. For a 0 to 2 years experience, the salary package is around 62,000 EGP, which moves to 78. And for a 15-20 year experienced person, it's 146,000 to 154. So comparing with India, it is more or less relatable and comparable at this point of time. But if you move from Cairo and gain an experience and explore opportunities in Dubai or UAE region, this same profile starts giving you far better returns than there in any other part of the country. So with 0 to 2 years experience, you can expect around 130,000 AEDs, which moves to 319 to 400,000 AEDs for a rail engineer with experience background. So I would encourage you to explore this. And again, with the disclaimer that the growth and salary packages vary based upon your level of skill, experience, and your perspective and attitude. So So these three things will determine your growth opportunities in any region in the world in the rail industry. Going forward from here, why are we doing this particular webinar? Why have we invited you? What is the purpose? First purpose is to create awareness. We want to create awareness among young engineers and also Indian engineers and Railway Academy alumni about international opportunities. We want them to be ambitious, and we want them to consider international opportunities in future. So the first step to that is to create awareness. And this is our primary objective for organizing this webinar. Second one is that we have collaborated with Miss University of Science and Technology to launch new age course programs. And in the coming months, we will be launching course programs on not only railways, but our course programs will also cover drone technologies, electronic system design and manufacturing, data engineering, artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, Internet of Things. So we will be launching newer course programs addressing a wider technology sectors, because we feel that cybersecurity applications will find a significant role in rail industry, and so would be artificial intelligence. Internet of Things would play a major role in predictive maintenance. Drone technologies would be used extensively in the coming years for track inspections, predictive maintenances, and even research and surveys. So the local manufacturing industry within railways will be boosted through ESDM, electronic system design and manufacturing. India is putting a lot of thrust in developing semiconductor solutions for various industries, and railway is also putting in immense thrust in this. So there is a huge amount of investments planned in the India region on ESDM. There's data engineering and machine learning will also play a significant role in rail and transportation sector. So we are looking at launching courses around these in collaboration with the esteemed Miss University of Science and Technology. The coming programs which we plan to announce in next 3 months would be on drone technology, track engineering, rail system engineering, cybersecurity, and artificial intelligence. It will be open for all branches of engineering, 2200 hours live online training by global experts. There will be hands-on project work, placement assistance internationally. We have tied up with rail professionals and a couple of more organizations we are looking at collaborating with in next few months to help and support our students to acquire good career options internationally. The certificates for the Egypt region would be delivered by in collaboration with Mast University and us. With this, I would like to invite our expert for today, Ahmed Nabil Ramadan, who has worked as technical track work engineer and is currently a PhD candidate in transportation geotechnics engineering in Beijing. And welcome, Ahmed.
Hello, everyone. Hello, Sumit. In the beginning, I'd like to thank you for your informative introduction about some projects, or especially for Egypt, and also the collaboration will be between Railway Academy and Mast University. I just want to ask you, can I control the screen, or
I think you can share your screen. I think we've shared the common presentation, so you can share the screen and take it forward from here. So participants, I'll stop presentation. You may share your screen now. So participants, Ahmed will be sharing more details about various projects which are coming up in the MENA region. So he's compiled a concise but very insightful summary on the projects. He'll talk about them. And we will open the session for questions once his presentation is done. But I would request everyone to please keep sharing your queries and questions in the chat box so that we could take them up. please type in your queries, whichever queries and questions you have, which you'd like to ask from our experts, even university officials and us combined. So you can write your questions and we'll take them up after Ahmed completes his presentation. Over to you, Ahmed, now. Thank you.
Thank you, Sam. I'd like also to thank Professor Ghada Amir for her attendance and attendance also from Master University of Technology, Science and Technology. So just after summit, what he has introduced, I'd like to just introduce my experience is that I have I have worked for different projects like development of railway level crossing. I also worked for the maintenance and renewal project for Egyptian Railway. Besides that, I worked as a designer for the infrastructure of the workshop of Kodika workshop in subway or metro line number one. Also, I worked in the Arab contractor company as a tender or as a technical engineer. So I was involved in different projects like tender projects. I worked as a technical engineer. I also worked for the high-speed train project, HSR, in Egypt for construction as a deputy track manager. And besides that, I also worked as a part of time for a technical, as a technical engineer. Besides that, also, I worked for the maintenance of the high-speed train, the strategy, the plans that they are doing for the perspective of this project. So, to continue what Sumit is already introduced, this we have different projects in the MENA region. MENA region is a meaning or the abbreviation of the Middle East and the North Africa region. So we have different projects like with what we have already in Dubai. We have the Dubai Metro Blue Line. We have in Abu Dhabi also Abu Dhabi Metro. In Saudi Arabia, Riyadh Metro. Sure, in Egypt, we are doing different, or from one to six, we have about we have about now six lines of metro. Three of them is already under operation, and the other three will be constructed. I'm not sure about the time, but sure they already started it. Also in United Arab Emirates, there is a connection between it and other countries like Saudi Arabia and Bahrain. You know, there is a big project that will be also happening in the Gulf area, connecting the Gulf area countries like Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Kuwait, and Bahrain. Besides that, also we already we can see a big project also in Iraq. It is Baghdad Metro. They already started the feasibility study. So for more information about each project, as we can see here, this is a map of their network in United Arab Emirates. I'm talking about the left side. So the orange color, it's meaning the future expansion or the future projects that will be done. Some of them is already defined. For example, the metro of Abu Dhabi is already defined as a date of that, but others is not clarified till now. Also, there is a project in Saudi Arabia, as I explained, connected it with Kuwait. For also Abu Dhabi, we have Dubai Metro Blue Line. We have much information about it. The length of this project or this line is about 15.5 kilometer. It will be underground, and they predicted that they will have about 56,000 of passenger per hour in both direction will be transferred. In Abu Dhabi, there also Abu Dhabi Metro project. There are some information about it. The length of that is about 130 kilometer. And you can also search about, if you'd like to have more information about this project, you can also go to the internet and search for more information. You know, if you'd like to join a big company, because more of these projects will be operated or will be constructed by international companies. So you it's better to read more about the projects that they will have to, and get more information. Be ready for the interview by more information about each project. This also about Riyadh Metro project. Besides that, we have Cairo Metro line number 6 now. They already constructed, under construction now. So for example, the tunnel work is already started. Also the construction of a station also is started by Egyptian companies. In United Arab Emirates also, there is a linkage between United Arab Emirates and Oman. This is a Gulf. This is a Gulf train network that I mentioned just now. Connection also between Riyadh and Kuwait. It will be done with 115 kilometers. Regarding Africa, also there is a big project that will be constructed in between three countries. For example, the first one is between three countries like Zambia, Congo, and Angola. By the way, we have a big competition here in this project between Chinese and the American companies, how to construct or which one will construct it. Also, we have a connection between the Kalahari and the Gaborone in Mumbai, exactly in Botswana. So more information you can find it inside the by just Googling it. And as you can see, we have many, many chances, many projects around us, just in Egypt. You know, in Egypt, we have high-speed train, construction now is working, and maintenance will be after that. LRT is already done, and the last phase is under construction now. Metro lines, monorail. So not just in Egypt, but also outside of Egypt, we have many projects. So it's better to prepare yourself and be ready to work in such a project, because once you have a big chance to work with a big company or international company like Siemens, Rascom, whatever the company name, so you will gain more information, more experience about it, and to be ready for that chance, it's better to prepare yourself well. Increase your skills, increase your knowledge by reading, by enrolling in different courses. So this is just advice. This is just advice for you. Not just graduation certificate is enough. Really, that is not enough now. Once you are graduated, so you will find a big competition, especially if the field is narrow and there are many engineers in this field. But railway engineering, or railway scope now, is we don't have much engineers, so you can prepare yourself well, just somewhat, then you can join any project also. I hope you can join any project. So regarding the technical session now, this is the content that I have. I already introduced different projects that we have, not just in Egypt, but around Egypt. I will start to explain about track components and its characteristics, the track construction, track maintenance and renewal. Then join. I will introduce modern technology for track engineering. I will give you also general idea or general information about the interfaces with other scope, between track work scope and other scopes. Also a general idea about RAMS, ISA certificate. And finally, I will end with railway accident, because you know that is more important to understand how the accident happened or what is the problem that the track facing. Because you have to keep that in mind once you are doing the construction or the design. You have to say, okay, this problem will be done by this problem. Okay, so I have to consider it in my mind now, then I can handle it or I can cover it from the beginning, sure, before starting the project. So for track components and its characteristics, we have different systems of railway track. We have ballasted track and ballastless track. Ballasted track, we have stones, it's black stones. You can find that in Egyptian National Railway, because all the network that we have in Egypt for Egyptian National Railway is already ballasted track. So we have a stones. The size of that is ranging from 25 millimeters to 62 millimeters. This is the supporting of the track. Besides that, we also have ballasted track or slab track. this track is constructed from concrete. We have settled the rails on concrete slab. You know, the oldest one, according to the history, the oldest one or the oldest system is a ballasted track. We have about 60 to 70% around the world are using the ballasted track. The other or the other percentage is related to the concrete or the ballasted track. So why we are doing that? Sure, we are doing that to sustain the load that came from the vehicle, that came from the trains. So we have vertical stresses that came from the trains, I mean from the wheel of the train. We have vertical stresses. We have longitudinal stresses. And the last one is the horizontal stresses. So the main or the big stresses will we have in the track is the vertical stresses. So the vertical stresses, sure, came from the load, came from the weight of the vehicle, whatever the vehicle containing passenger or goods. So the stresses came from the wheel moving to the rail. After that, it will move to the sleeper. By the way, the sleeper is a you can see in the left side photo. This is the sleeper, the concrete sleeper exactly below the rail. I'm trying to give you more information because maybe we have fresh graduates. I think we have already, so you have to learn somewhat or give my idea what I'm explaining to you. So after going to the sleeper, after stress is going to the sleeper, it will move to the ballast layer, the stones that I already mentioned before. After that, the stresses will be distributed to the caving layer, or we can say the sub-ballast layer. Then the last one is the subgrade. So going to track cross-section, we can say this is the track cross-section from top to bottom. We have rail, then faster, then sleeper, then ballast, then sub-ballast or caving layer. So the rail, it is shaped in this way to sustain the vertical, horizontal, and the longitudinal stresses that I mentioned just now. So you know the rails usually is about 18 meters. How to connect each rail with each other? Because we have to continue the work. For example, we have 1 kilometer of rail. So how to connect each one with each one? By flash plate. We can see in the left side, this is flash plate. Just a connection between two rails. Okay, so after that, or below that, we have a fastening system. Fastening system is just to hold or to keep the position of the rail in its position or in its right position, to not move right, left, up, down. Okay, sure, we can say permeability or clearance to let the rail move up and down, sure, because we have here in fastening system, we have a clip. And we have also rail bed below the rail. Exactly this black color is rail bed. Rail bed to sustain somewhat or to make, to give some elasticity to the track infrastructure, I mean. So after the fastening system, we have sleepers here, concrete sleepers, as we can see in this photo. We have two types of the sleepers. The first one is the beginning one or the closest one to us is a block. It's mono block concrete sleeper, and the other one we can find that at the end of the on the photo is a twin block, two blocks of concrete. Each block is under each rail. So after that, we have the ballast layer. This is the main. We can say this is the main, one of the main elements or the track elements for the construction or for this structure. The ballast layer is the main characteristic of that is to distribute the load that came from the sleepers and move it to the subgrade or to the sub-ballast layer. Also, one of that is one of the main characteristics of the ballast layer is to make or to allow the water to drain out of the track. So if we have much rain here or we have the water came from the ground, as a groundwater, I mean, if it was increased. So we have to sustain or to be sure that the water will go out of the track. usually the track level will be higher, so the water ground will not affect the track. But sometimes, or because of the old or the age of the tracks, maybe we will have some troubles, or we will have some construction work besides the track, so maybe the track level will not be high enough. After that, we have a sub-ballast layer. Sub-ballast layer is just, you know, something in between to make it to be as a component in between ballast and the subgrade to decrease the stresses that came from ballast layer because of the moving trains, and move it or transfer it to the subgrade layer to make it easier somewhat, to make it lower somewhat. After that, we have subgrade layer. So this is the generally the track structure, or the, generally the track component of the ballast track. So going to the next one is the track design and the construction. You know, in the beginning, if we have a project like high speed train or whatever the type of the project, metro, whatever. So we have main criteria first, like what is the gauges that I will use. The gauge meaning is the distance between each rail. You know, we have, as we explained here, we have two rails. So the distance between each rail, between the two rails here is called gauge. So usually, or the widest graded one is the 1,435 millimeter. Okay, this is the distance between the two rails. After that, we also have to design, okay, what is the speed that I'm looking for? What is the client looking for the speed? For example, if he is looking for 90 kilometer per hour, if he's looking for 200, 300, what is the speed that that will be applied for this project? Because each speed, it has different design or have different criteria for the design of the track. And many consideration has to be taken, not just for the track alignment, but also for the track design. I mean, for the thickness of the ballast layer, because that is also regarding or related to the design phase. So thickness of the ballast layer, thickness of the sub ballast layer, the transversal slope, everything related to the track has to be accurately designed according to the requirement that came from the client. For example, the client wanted to connect from point A to point B, and I wanted to make it with 250 kilometers per hour. Okay, this is the first point. So what else do you have? What's the type of the cars, or what is the type of the train that you will move here? Is it freight train, passenger train? What is the load that I will have on the track? So different things you have to consider during the design, and you have to following the standard and the requirements of the project to know if you are working well or not. Sure, you know, the standard are the main thing, or the important things that you have to follow. Whatever you're doing in the design, you have to follow the standard. For example, the standard give you a range from 0 to 5. Okay, so you must be between this number, not more or not less. Okay, so this is generally about the design. So going to the construction, as you can see here, by the way, this is a project of high speed train or HSR in Egypt. The green line, you know, the HSR project, it has three lines: the green line, the blue line, and the last one is the red line. I worked as for the construction during my times that I was working in this project. I worked also as a position. My position was a deputy track manager for this one. So in the beginning, we have earthwork. Earthwork is meaning that we are preparing the subgrade layer or anything related to the track. For example, if we have a box culvert, we have to finish it. If we have some tunnels, we have to finish it. If we have some crossing below the track, I mean, or below the subgrade layer, we have to finish it. Everything, we have to prepare it until a fixed level. After that, we were going to the construction of the ballast layer, okay? Or for the ballast track. So the first one, as I mentioned, after the earthwork, we have sub-ballast, okay? So also sub-ballast is related to the earthwork. After that, we have to continue the work with construction of the ballast layer. So Generally, we have about 30 centimeter of the ballast thickness, I mean below the bottom of the sliver. You know, this is the sliver, the concrete sliver, okay? So below the bottom of the sliver, generally we have about 30 centimeter, okay? Sure, each thickness will be defined regarding the design, regarding the standards that we are following, okay? So after applying or after installing the ballast layer, we do that in different step, okay? Then we can put the slivers on it. After putting the sliver, we will install the rails, okay? But sure, between or before putting the rails, we have to be ready with the rail bed and so on, but we can do that after. Anyway, this is the general consequences that we are following: ballast layer, slivers, and rails, okay? So regarding maintenance and renewal, in fact, if we are talking about the maintenance of the track, we have two main big machines that we will use, okay? The first one is a tamping machine. Tamping machine is doing squeezing for the ballast stones below the slivers. So we wanted to ensure that below slivers, there is enough ballast below the slivers, okay, to sustain the stresses came from the moving trains. So if we don't have enough ballast below the sliver or around the sliver, by the way, so we will have some problem related to the settlement and deformation for the track alignment. We are doing that by the tamping machine. This machine is a very big machine. We just looking for or focusing with the tamping units that we have here. This tamping unit has that tins is already or tins are already going to the ballast layer and move, make some vibration and make a squeezing for the ballast to be sure that is okay. The gap between slivers and the ballast layer is already covered by the ballast stones. Okay, so not just a stamping machine, but also we have profiling machine. Profiling machine is also one of the main, we can say also a main machine we are using for the maintenance of the track to distribute the ballast along the track and to be sure that, okay, we have enough ballast here, then the tamping machine can go to the track and do its work or its activity. Okay. So this is general about the interfaces with the track work. So as you know that we are constructing the track, but we are not working only for the track. I mean the project, it has different scopes, not just the track work. We have civil works, we have rolling stock. It will be after the track and finish everything. We have electrification, we have signaling, okay? So for the track works, as I mentioned, we have design and installation. Not just that, but also you have procurement and you have to define the storage places and define the area and the place of that. And you have to choose that correctly according to your availability to be sure that, okay, I can move my things or the material to the track easily. And also it will be protected from weather condition and other conditions. This is for track walls also. We have manufacture phase, and during the manufacture, you have to ensure the quality of the materials that you are buying. So manufacture and the testing, procurement phase, design, installation, all of that you have to consider during the managing or the project manager has to consider this point to be covered well and to be planned very well. Then the progress will be better. We will not be away from the defined date or the defined project date. During the work of the track work, we have civil works, we have electrification, signaling, rolling stock. You have to consider also the other scopes. Okay, if the civil work is not finished, so how can I start? So I have some problems. So if they didn't finish everything, but there are some activities they can work or they can continue working simultaneously with my work. Okay, which one can be accepted, which one cannot be accepted? Maybe something will affect my work. So totally I will refuse. Maybe something will not affect my work. Okay, it could be done. You understand, Nasik. So Electrification also, once I'm doing the track installation and there is a scope of electrification, they wanted to insert or to install the columns that will load or sustain the cable. Okay, so how to manage that? When they will start, when I can start, when they can go to the track, and when they can't go to the track. So each thing has to be defined exactly. Because if you didn't define that, or if you didn't understand this one, you will face some problems. You will face some delay during the construction phase for you and for them. Both of you will be affected. Signaling also the same. Rolling stock also the same. For example, the rolling stock will be ready to the track after 1 month. Okay, but my track is already constructed, but I didn't finish the last step to finish the track, the grinding phase, for example. So how can we do that? Because if I didn't finish the grinding phase, okay, how can they move the rolling stock? Because it will be affected also if we have something is not ready in the track. So many things you have to consider during the construction phase related to other scopes. The other one here is talking about the RAMS and the ISO certificate. You know, RAMS is an abbreviation of reliability, availability, maintainability, and safety. So each part here is related. In fact, RAMS is related more for the signaling and the rolling stock. But you also have to consider their investigation or their a check. Okay. Sometimes you will find that the RAMS, you can apply that for the procurement phase related to the materials that you will buy. For example, I will buy the rails from any country, from China, for example. Okay, so what I have to do, or what is the reliability, availability, maintainability, especially this part is related for track structure. I mean, this part is very, very important for the turnouts. Turnouts is a part of the track elements that they are using to maneuvering the train from side to another side, or from the main side, from the main track to the side. Okay. The ISO certificate is very important now recently to be sure that, okay, the track is certified and you can let the train run with its full speed according to the design, sure. But before getting the ISO certificate, they will do many checks on the track. And they will check everything about also the track design, if that is right or not. If your curve design, for example, is right or not. If the slope is right or not. Is the construction phase is right or not. Okay, so many things have to be considered during the investigation phase. Okay, and during sure the construction and design, because after that someone will come and assessing your work, because ISA, you know, ISA is an abbreviation of Independent Safety Assessment or Independent Safety Assessment Certificate. Okay, so you have to be sure that everything has been done in a good way and in a correct way regarding the standards and the requirement of the project. This slide is about modern technologies for track engineering. You know, recently, not recently, in fact, this train, especially maglev train, I'm talking about the right side photo, China has already have it. About maybe two trains now. Yeah. China has about two trains now of maglev train. I'm talking about under operation. Maglev train is the idea of magnetic field, just using reverse magnetic field to be sure that okay, the track will be the train will be away from the track, so you already decrease one of the resistance force to let the train moving so quickly, because there is no friction between the train and the track. Okay, so the friction is less now. We can say the friction is zero, so it will be very, very fast. Not just this idea, but also there is a hyperloop on the left side. Hyperloop is make a vacuum tube. If we have a vacuum tube, there is no air inside it. So we also decrease the resistance between the train body and the air forces, we can say. Because once you are running or once you are moving by your car, by yourself, will find something is resisting your movement. This is air. So once you are decreasing or ignoring this element, so your speed will be higher. You can keep your speed also, not just higher, but also you can keep your power and keep your speed for a long time. This is for the track structure. And if we talk about the machines or the timing, machines or the technology that they are using now in the track structure for investigation, in the left side, we have ultrasonic to investigate each part, not just the rails, as we can see here, not just the rails can be investigated or can be checked. For example, there are welding points, there are fish connection between two rails as fish plates that we have here, or other things. Okay, not just this, but also you can discover or investigate the ballast layer, how is the shape of that, how is the contamination inside this ballast layer, what is the falling ratio, what is the falling percentage inside the ballast layer, what is the thickness of the ballast layer, is it correct now or not, the ballast layer can sustain the loads that can come to the track or not. Okay, that you can understand according to analyzing the results that came from ultrasonic investigation. Okay, sure, sleepers and fasting system also can be checked by this system. Regarding the timing machine, in fact, I saw recently an important machine, also called the timing machine. I can't remember the company, and maybe System 7, something like this. They have an important technology about this machine. You know, the timing machine is not just make it squeezing for the ballast layer, but also this machine is already, we can say, mobile controlling. After you finish the work, they make some statistics and using the AI to be more controlling the track. I'm talking about especially for this one for maintenance. I mean, sure, you can use it for construction, but it's usually for this idea, usually used for the maintenance. So you can have a plan, or we can have a strategic plan about the maintenance that you will have for the track. The last one here is about the railway track accidents. You know, that is important. You have to know that, because maybe during the construction, especially the construction, maybe during the construction, some faults will be happened or something can be covered. Well, sure, the quality team has to consider, fulfill the investigation and check for the work. And sure, there is a consultant and the owner sure can check everything. But something happened by fault, and something happened during the time, you know, maybe after 10 years, maybe after 20, 30, 50, okay? So this is not only related to the construction, but also related to the maintenance. So that is more important for the maintenance. As we can see here, the first photo, there is a big accident in USA. It has a flooding. Flooding is a big issue, in fact. But they don't have, you know, they don't have the civil work, or the, we can say, box culvert, or it's changing the water basin below the track to protect the track body, or to protect the track structure. Also, we have an accident in Marsa Matruh. This is flooding. You know, we have tried to move the water from the right side to the left side, but in fact, the diameter of this pipe is not enough. So the water came and hit everything in front of it, making this shape. As we can see in the third photo, there is a settlement before and after the bridge. You know, this is a bridge, and usually the bridge construction material is concrete, and below and after is the construction, or we can say the subgrade is just soil. So the fixation or the rigidity of the two particles or of the two elements that I mentioned, soil and the concrete, is there is a difference between them. So we are doing some concrete panels or some concrete slab below, before and after the bridge, to prepare the track or to prepare the train to move from high, not high, but we can, comparing with each other, we can say high somewhat, with high elasticity to rigidity somewhat, from the soil or from the ballasted track, normal track or usual track, to the bridge area, I mean. So that point also has to be considered and covered. The number four, this accident, in fact, it was in England. There is a pipe crossing the track, and there is a big settlement happening for this pipe, damaging happening for this pipe. So the track is already settled. By the time it's settled about 10 centimeters, then the track has an accident with a freight train. On the other side, we have buckling for the track. Maybe this is not buckling, I think. Yeah, this is a settlement, or maybe both of them, because the track is already welded continuously. So maybe after the settlement, the fixation, or you can say the fixation of the track, especially for the rails and slivers, is not enough. So the ballast layer not only moving the stresses from the train to the subgrade, but also make a horizontal fixation for the track. So the load, the longitudinal load, can be resisted by sliver, okay? By the weight of the sliver and the resistance with the ballast stone that beside it, right and left side. So different accidents or different problems has to be considered. This one is especially related to the maintenance. Okay, so this is generally, and I hope you can get somewhat from the general. Sure, this is general about each part that I explained here. And please, if you have any questions, just share it. Mr. Sumit, I think you can. Welcome.
Thank you, Ahmed, for this wonderful, precise session. So, I've tried to answer the questions in the chat itself. If you have any particular question, please type your questions in the chat. We will take them up. And I would also like to check if the internet issue at Professor Amir has been fixed. So, ma'am, if the issue is fixed, please unmute yourself.
Yes, Samat. Now now is working, Yani. So I need to thank you and thank all the audience today. And I need to focus that this topic is very important for all engineering sectors. As we mentioned, when we met in Egypt, I told you we in MES University for Science and Technology, we are caring about this training courses. And we hope in the future we make a special department for railway. So again, thank you very much. And thank you for everyone attend with us today. Thank you, Beth. Thank you, Samet. And I believe Dr. Mustafa can give a small hint about university. Dr. Mustafa, are you here? About the college? Dr. Mustafa? Okay, anyway. So Samet, if anyone of the audience need a question, I believe you can also add your email and they will add my email and they can send to us and we can follow up with them daily. If they face any questions or they need any project in the future in this sector.
Ma'am, there is one question which students are asking. When are we starting our course programs? So there are two people who have asked this question. So if you could give them some assurance about the timelines on starting the course programs.
Yeah. We now are signing the agreement with the Railway Academy. Once we sign the MOU, and they believe this will be within this month, inshallah. So after Ramadan, we can announce about the starting of the training courses, inshallah.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And if anyone need to follow up, he can send me an email, and they will tell him exactly when will he start, inshallah. Once I get once we get the final approval, I believe now, so we can sign this week, inshallah, or next week.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much. And I think Dr. Mustafa has also joined. Sir, if you could unmute yourself to share some details about the university.
Yeah, Dr. Mustafa, if you can just speak about the college and the university within 3 minutes only. Dr. Mustafa,
evening,
are you...
Everyone.
Yeah. So please start.
Yes. I first thank Mr. Sumit and Engineer Ahmed Nabil for this amazing webinar. And I'd like to introduce our College of Engineering in Master University. We have 10 departments. The first department is construction engineering. The construction engineering program provides graduates with the skills of to design components of construction engineering to achieve desired goal. The second department is architecture engineering. It provides a high quality education to advance the profession of architecture, urban design, and planning. The third department is the mechanical engineering. The mechanical engineering program stresses the role of engineering in planning, creating machines, devices, and systems, and the skillful management of projects. The fourth department is industrial and system engineering. It involves the synthesis and the application of scientific principles to the design, installation, and improvement of integrated system of people, materials, and equipment to provide the most efficient and effective operating and work environment. The fifth department is the computer and software engineering. It encompasses a variety of computer fields, from designing and modeling devices used in computer systems to configuring large system and computer networks, including embedded systems and computer programs, and of course, artificial intelligence. The sixth department is electronic and communication engineering. These departments are essential to almost every industry. It is, in fact, difficult to imagine a modern industry which doesn't require the services of the communication and electronics. The seventh department is biomedical engineering. This department is committed to providing a distinguished higher education that gives the knowledge to students and the skills that meet the requirements of the healthcare equipment in this field. The eighth department is electrical power and machinery engineering. The electrical power and machinery engineering program aims to prepare engineers at the professional level to plan and design electrical power generation plants and manage renewable energy. The last department is mechatronics engineering. It's about today's world. It's where electronics, computers, and mechanics converge to bring the automated devices we use in our everyday lives, both in the home and everywhere. This is our nine departments, besides the basic science department, which provides the material of the basic science, such as physics, chemistry, and math. This is a brief of our college, and we are looking forward to the collaboration with the Railway Academy to introduce a good courses and help anyone who want to be in this field of railway engineering. Thank you, Mr. Somers. Mr. Somit.
Thank you, Dr. Mustafa. Thank you for this explanation. And I would conclude this session by saying that the recording for this entire session would be available on our YouTube channel. And I would, you could scan the QR codes on your screen to subscribe to the channel. And this recording would be updated on our YouTube channel in next 12 hours. You can revisit the whole session again and refer it and even forward it to your within your network to spread the awareness about opportunities in MENA region. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Amir. Thank you, Dr. Mustafa. Thank you, Mr. Ahmed Nabil, for taking out your precious time. And most importantly, I would like to thank all our participants who took out their time on a Saturday to attend this session. And we are really thankful to you. We will be commencing and announcing and commencing the sessions very soon as we formalize our association with Miss University of Science and Technology. In the meanwhile, if you'd like to know anything about our course programs or our upcoming webinars, so in the coming weeks, we are looking at doing a webinar on drone technology for railway sector specifically. So the dates would be announced most probably in the next week. So please attend that. That's a very interesting a drone tech presentation we are preparing for you, followed by we'll be doing a specific session on rail opportunities in the Middle East region, specifically UAE, covering UAE. So we'll be announcing these notification onto our LinkedIn page, YouTube and Facebook. So I invite you all to subscribe to them. And thank you, everyone. Thank you so much and have a wonderful evening. Thank you very much,
Samit. And thank you for everyone attend with us today. And please send us also the link for the coming webinar and anything, because we all will always be participating in this very important topics.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a good night. Shukran. Assalamu alaikum.